Really my pleasure to well, introduce someone that probably needs no introduction and to welcome him back to the Pacific Northwest. Dwayne has participated in our conferences in the past, and it's really good to see him here today. As many of you know and have appreciated and gone back actually to the Dakota Lakes Research Farm, I have myself and many of you have made that trip back. It's good to see him here, and we're looking forward to Dr. Dwayne Beck here this morning talk to us. Thank you so much, Dwayne.
Thanks. You know, one of the things, we farm soils that are very similar in terms of structure to the pluse soils. They're wind blown. They're not volcanic, but they're wind blown out of the glacier, and they're similar to the volcanic soils in Australia, and they do have some of those, or in Argentina. They're dissimilar from the ones in Australia, and one of the things that we found, and we got into what we're doing because of irrigation, and I'm not going to go through that history, but making water go into the ground is where we have focused everything. Make the water go in the ground where it falls and keep it there and use it and take the E out of ET and all those things. And once you develop good macropore structure, and if I would pull a tillage tool through, and we've done these studies, something like the vertical tillage tools will drop the infiltration rate in half with one pass. So you gotta be very careful about not closing off the macropores in our less soils where we have very little particle size segregation. We need those big holes. So that's one of the things. And I agree with what John said about you can't build organic matter without putting in the nutrients. And I did a whole presentation one time about immobilization. When you went through undergraduate school, if you did, in agronomy, you learned about immobilization of nitrogen and how bad a thing that was. You put this nitrogen on your straw and it gets immobilized and you don't get to use it for your next crop. And then now we call it sequestration, right? And I said sequestration is like immobilization, just had a better press agent. And so I did a whole presentation on that one time and had a lot of fun with it. But the Dakota Lakes Research Farm, there's our residue and our kind of machine that we use. We're constantly screwing with machinery, but machinery isn't all that important because someday it's going to be irrelevant. We're not going to need to have machines like that to do our seeding. But this is a photograph of the main station at the farm. We have both irrigated and dry land, and we have some rough country, and we have stuff off station that we farm that's pretty rough, but not like John Ashelman's. It's owned by farmers, which is incredibly important. Both irrigation and dry land, 100% low disturbance, no-till forever. The production enterprise, which I manage, and probably most of what I'll talk about today is what we learned on the production enterprise, that profit supports the research. But the importance of the farmer ownership is that the priorities of the farmers, I'm now working with some of the grandsons of the people who started this operation. Their goals have not changed in the last 100 years of those families. Your family goals haven't changed in the last 100 years. But every new administrator we get at a university has a whole new set of goals. It has really not a lot to do with what your goals are. And it's okay for him to have his goals, but those research stations and the goals reflects what the university's goals are. And we love South Dakota State University and the people that work from there, and I'm actually employed by them. But the goals of the farmer and the research farm are very parallel, and that's really what needs to happen. And those guys help us then sort through the mess. This is a look at our vegetation. The first time I went to Australia, I showed this slide, and I said the only place we grow trees is in the very major drainage ways, because not because it's too cold, but because we don't have enough water at the right period of time. Where in most of the farming areas of Australia, the native vegetation would be trees, because the rain comes in the wintertime and gets deeper than what grasses can go. And somebody said, well, where did all your trees go? I just said, well, we don't have trees other than the major drainage ways. And they said, where did your trees go? And I said, Paul Bunyan cut them down. So you guys all know that joke, but you don't, right? See, you have to explain Paul Bunyan. You got to be careful when you tell jokes when you travel internationally, because they don't catch them all the time. They don't have the same background. 1970, the average wheat price was $1.37 a bushel, and the average price of barrel of oil was $3.39. Okay? Conjure on that. What's that price of barrel of oil today? A little on the north side of 100. In Minnesota, where tillage is king, it takes slightly under 10 gallons of diesel fuel per acre for tillage, seeding, and harvest. And they till the ever-loving heck out of it. It's only 10 gallons. We have very efficient machinery now. It takes the energy of 1 gallon of diesel fuel to manufacture, transport, and apply 5 pounds of nitrogen. So in Minnesota, where they apply 150 pounds of N per acre, that's 30 gallons of diesel fuel, if you do the math. 80% of the total input costs in agriculture can be traced directly to energy. 120 years ago, that was zero. In 120 years, it will have to be zero again. It's about time we start trying to figure this out before we run into this thing and went, oh, darn. This is a picture of our cold press, the oil coming from our cold press. We presently use it to press all of our oilseed crops on farm. 2,390 pounds of canola will give us about 625 pounds of oil. At our yield of canola, we get about 60 to 80 gallons an acre of straight vegetable oil. And then we have a meal that is about almost a 50% protein meal that makes wonderful livestock feed. And right out here someplace, there's a poster on feeding canola meal to heifers. And it works really well. Ours has a little more oil in than the solvent extracted stuff, which is good. Makes it better feed. I am a farmer. I take sunlight, water, and carbon dioxide to make products I can sell. Trouble with most farmers is they want to consider themselves corn farmers, wheat farmers, soybean farmers, pig farmers, whatever. I don't care if it's pink elephants. If I can grow it and make money and it's good for the ecosystem, I'm going to do that. But our job is to harvest carbon dioxide. How good a job do you do in your fallow year of harvesting carbon dioxide? And then we like these terms like sustainable, no-till, regenerative, organic, zero-till, direct seed. New one is soil health, right? We're all into soil health, but we don't have a clue what the hell it is. Define for me a beautiful woman or a handsome man. How tall, how much weight, what color hair, what color eyes? Can't do it, right? But we all know one when we see one. This is one of my favorite, ethical oil. This is a Canadian thing. This is for the guy that follows me, right? We're doing ethical oil in Canada as compared to them Arabian countries. Because we don't beat our wives and stuff in Canada, so it's better oil than the stuff we get from it, right? Is that, am I lying to you? No. See, he's sitting over there going, yeah, okay, yeah, we did that. We spend a lot of time trying to find what we should not do or what we should do. We're going to grow wheat better because we want to grow only wheat, so we spend all our time looking at this little tiny detail of how do we it isn't as good as it should be, and we're just trying to make it better and whatever. And we spend all of our research dollars focusing on these little tiny details. And we spend most of our research and management effort doing this instead of looking down the road, acting to get where we want to be. Where do you want to be in 30 years from now? What do you want your soils to look like 30 years from now? What do you want your families to be doing 30 years, 100 or 200 years from now? And what we do when we do this is we react from going somewhere we do not want to go instead of focusing on where we want to go. Right? We don't want to get this disease, or we don't want to get this bug, so we're going to get a variety that doesn't get this bug or whatever, instead of saying, well, this is what I want to do, I want to go there. It's a bit like trying to drive down the highway by looking at the edge of the ditch, and we do this in blizzards. Australians don't understand this either, right? Not an experience that they've had. If you've ever been to Australia, the ditches are full of snow, or full of trees, and if they had snow, they'd never get down that dang highway, right? Because the whole highway would drift in. But it's not the way you want to function. There's no better time than now, or actually about 5 years ago, to define where you want to be and where you want the Pacific Northwest to be 200 years or 600 years from now. 5 years ago was a good time to do it because we had a period here of high profitability. We could have made some strategic changes instead of reacting to, oh, damn, we got low prices and what we're doing really isn't working. So what 30 years of no-till and crop rotation work have taught me, remember, I'm a slow learner. I've learned more from farmers than they have learned from me. The advantage I have is I get to talk to a lot of farmers, and they sometimes make mistakes and they sometimes have successes, and I get to integrate all of that. I have learned more from observing nature than trying to change it. White European male ancestry people tend to come into an ecosystem and say, I want it to do this, so we'll build a dam, put in canals, we'll do all this stuff, instead of saying, oh, here's what this ecosystem does. What can I reproduce in that ecosystem? How can I harvest carbon and turn it into things that I can sell? No-till is just one tool among many that we use to help us manage our ecosystem. If you look at the Dakota Lakes mission statement, it says nothing about no-till. It says nothing about no-till in our title. We're here to manage an ecosystem. You can't manage an ecosystem with tillage. Mother Nature doesn't do tillage. So you have this ecosystem, this farm ecosystem that is a nice working circle for you, and all of a sudden you decide to take out tillage, but you don't want to change anything else, and the whole thing collapses. And then you spend the rest of your time trying to straighten out that thing, because you haven't really planned for being a new system. So let's simplify a little bit and look at these farming system components. You have a bunch that are cultural practices. You have technology, which is okay, and you have management, which is okay. But if you take out tillage, which is one of the cultural practices, and try to replace it only with technology, there is not enough technology available. I want to tell John that the United States has now passed Australia as a place with the most resistant weeds. We're very proud of that. It's like an Olympics thing, right? Australia is not real big in the Winter Olympics, by the way. Canadians are. Canadians really get into it. My wife's Canadian. Ooh. Around our house, you got to be really careful during the Winter Olympics. But there's not enough technology available. If it were available, we couldn't afford it. And even if we could afford it and it would be available, we can't sell it to the consumer. It's not the responsible thing to do. It's not the way we should be handling it. So we've got to replace cultural practices of tillage with other cultural practices. In nature, tillage is a catastrophic event. So we're going to take tillage out and replace it rotation, sanitation, and competition. Crop rotations, proper intensity. You have to use the water. You have to mimic what Mother Nature does with water in that ecosystem, which makes Australia and the Pacific Northwest, these winter rainfall areas, are somewhat challenging. But they also provide opportunities because your water is so effective. It comes during the cool part of the year, where ours comes during the hot part of the year. A lot of it we can't use very well. It's not as efficient. We have to have enough diversity to keep these bugs and things confused. The main station at Dakota Lakes, we've not used an insecticide in 12 years because we have friendlies. we have our beneficials. And once you do your rotations right, you really get a very stable and sustainable profitability. We have to think about the water cycle. Are we matching the water cycle that's there? How is the energy flow? What percentage of the sunlight that falls on our land are we harvesting and turning into something beneficial, or are we wasting it because it's falling on bare ground and not being harvested? The mineral cycle, if we have a broken mineral cycle, we're going to lose the nutrients either to the waterways or to the air, or we're going to ship it out of the country. As a unit train of soybeans has 1,000,000 pounds of phosphorus. And if I ship that to China, they don't send me the poop back. Okay? And then the community dynamics. Do we have diversity out there in our community? As I said, farmers and ranchers harvest sunlight, carbon dioxide, and water. That's the only three things we have to export and import. In the native system in the Pacific Northwest, nothing ever left here. Some nutrients went to the ocean with the rivers, and the salmon gathered nutrients from the ocean and brought it back into the inland. And nothing ever net left. And if we continue to export, we're going to turn the United States in 600 years or 1,000 years into a desert. So we've got to stop that. Some of what we produce is human food. We need to be aware of nutritional issues and off-site impacts. If we want to eat beef, maybe we should concentrate in learning to grow beef instead of producing corn or barley that feeds beef and feedlots. In Alberta, for instance. Weeds and diseases are Mother Nature's way of adding diversity to a system that lacks it. If you don't have enough diversity, add beneficial diversity of your own. We need diversity in seeding date and rooting pattern and root architecture and residue type and insect pests, weed suppression, microorganisms. John's right with, if you do this thing, you can get a real stunt from no-till if you've got these really tight rotations. We saw the same thing in our long-term rotation studies, which you guys have all seen, and they're on my website. And also diversity of beneficials and more. The goal is to be so inconsistent in sequence and interval that you keep her confused. And I've got a thing on my website where I talk about rotation types. So if you go to DakotaLakes.com and look for a 214 thing on agronomic systems, you'll see that paper. But let's talk specifically a little bit about weeds this morning, because we can't talk about all this stuff. This is some work by Randy Anderson, who ran the Akron Research Station for a while and done a lot of our weed stuff with us, because he's really good at doing weed stuff. He's the detail guy. He's now at Brookings at the ARS lab there. If you take goat grass or downy brome, what you guys would call cheatgrass, leave it on the surface and see what happens to it. After 2 or 3 years, it has almost no viability. So if you plant crops that aren't a problem to control this or outcompete this, these weeds, which isn't wheat, wheat's got the same growth cycles, downy brome and goat grass, then the weed pressure goes to almost nothing. Same thing happens with diseases. They go to almost nothing if you give them a long break, and that long break is the important part. Here's a study that we did with cheatgrass early on. If you have 10 cheatgrass weeds and each have 100 seeds, what happens to the number of cheatgrass you have with different rotations? Well, if you have a rotation, the red bar, where you're doing every other year wheat, fallow wheat, in 7 years you'd have 10 million of them. If you have a rotation that's wheat and 2 years out of wheat and then back into wheat, in 17 years you have almost no weed seeds anymore. Don't have to use a cheatgrass herbicide. If you want to do half wheat, you're better off doing 2 wheats and 2 outs, which is the green line. And then it starts to blow up on you in 10 or 11 years. And then you switch out and do something else, okay? Using that property of that plant against it. If you do continuous wheat, you have 10 million in 3 years. Well, this is an example of what happens with resistant wheat. As soon as you get your first resistant one out there, if you're doing continuous where you miss it time after time, like the guys in the Corn Belt, they have 10 million of them in 3 years. If they're doing corn soybeans, they have 10 million in 7 years. Blows up very, very fast. We also did a thing where we looked at competitiveness of hybrids. Arapaho is very tall. These are all hardbred winners. Very tall and very competitive. Carl 92 was short, high yielding. And so where we had high pressure, which is this, a wheat corn pea rotation, where we did no burn down in the pea year and no post-emerge control of the grass. We basically let the cheat grass that was there go to seed during the pea year. The short stature guy didn't do very well. Where we put on just a burn down, it was about a push, but where we did a burn down and we controlled that late germinating cheatgrass in the spring, then we could take advantage of the high yielding. So it's not an easy thing to figure out all these little deals, but sanitation, taking care of that thing. Resistance, this is what happens now with Beyond in Kansas. You can see down the bottom light line there, cheatgrass, they can only get 65% control, and goatgrass 40% control now with Clearfield technology. So they come up with Clearfield technology, okay, then we'll just keep doing our stupid stuff. And then they ruin that technology. You know, the technology's nice, but we need to take care of it.